Hey everyone, this is Jason and Mickey's here as well.
Hey everybody.
We are leaving this special message for you on Christmas Eve and hope you've been enjoying all of the great content over there on the Retro Network that we've had leading up to Christmas. And we are really excited to get some downtime with the family. At least I am, Mick.
Well, I'm excited about downtime. Now, the family part of it, I'm going to have plenty. I'm not saying I'm not looking forward to seeing the family, but Christmas brings a lot of time with the family. I am equally looking forward to the time in the days after Christmas where old daddy over here gets a little bit of private time to do some stuff I need to catch up on.
That's right. Yeah, we have been plagued with the flu. The oldest got it last week diagnosed, and so he's been contagious for several days, and so we're having to do most of our Christmas stuff probably right on Christmas Day or the days after. So we're just kind of hanging out at the house and trying to not get the flu leading up to Christmas.
But you know, it's a blessing, you know, it's a curse, but it's a blessing too that you can't go out and do all this other stuff, but it leaves time that you may not normally have for just sucking up all the Christmas content, you know, that you can find, and just kicking back on the couch. You know, I think that scene in Christmas Vacation when they're waiting on the in-laws to arrive and they're watching It's a Wonderful Life, Rusty's just kicked back in the den there. Man, that's a perfect couple of days before Christmas. Just kick back, lounging, watching Christmas movies.
That's right. Yeah, I was even in the spirit Friday. I took a little page out of your cookbook there, made sausage balls for the first time for my crew, and I was feeling great. You know, it's fun to have that preparation time leading up to like a big meal. And I know you love to cook. I'm not the biggest of cooks, but there's something, you don't get that much time usually to cook a huge meal when you're going through the rut of, you know, the work week, and it's usually around the holidays you get a chance to do that, and it's enjoyable.
Well, you sent me that note that you made those sausage balls, and you told me what you used. Did you say you used crescent dough?
I did. Yeah, I didn't. I'm not the made from scratch person, but I was looking for something quick and something I could kind of dip my toes in the water, you know.
Okay. Well, if you use some kind of dough, then you didn't make sausage balls. No, I mean, really, would you use like little sausages and roll them up or something? Or
no, and I'm not talking about like pigs in a blanket. I had actual ground sausage, and I shredded a block of smoked cheddar, and took the crescent dough and cut it real, real fine, and kind of mixed all that together in a bowl and actually formed like sausage balls to cook in the oven.
Well, I can tell you an even easier way. You don't use any kind of pre-made dough. You just use 2 cups of Bisquick mix out of the pack and just dump it in and mix it all together with sausage and cheese and roll it up. That'll save you a step next time.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, but it does sound good, though. And then when I seen that, and I seen the crescent dough, it got me thinking about the little smoked sausages.
Yes.
I'm like, dang, I want to roll some of those up with some of that smoked cheddar in a crescent roll and bake them suckers, make little Christmassy pigs in blankets out of them.
Yeah, yeah. That's something we do a lot of as our appetizers, mainly, is those pigs in a blanket. I'm pretty much known for them, but it's nothing special. It's just getting those little smoky sausages and rolling them up in crescent dough and cooking them up. But
you said the your sausage ball concoction was a big hit, though. I think you texted me there, right?
Yeah, I made those. The wife made these biscuit sandwiches too. She just took like the canned biscuit dough and put ham. I think she did ham, eggs, and cheese, and then you split the biscuit in half, and then you put that top half down, close it up, and well, we put them in the oven together and fed the crew breakfast, and yeah, they really appreciated that. So that might be a tradition I have to do every once in a while, is cooking breakfast.
Yeah, that's not a bad idea. We had a big Christmas dinner at work, potluck, and there's about 50 people there at night, so you know, and everybody brought something. We had quite a big meal. Mm-hmm. I have been eating, good gosh, all these companies that deal with our company sending in these different tins of nuts and candies. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, we get some of that.
I think in the last 7 days, and I'm not exaggerating because I got on a scale, I've gained 10 pounds in the last 7 days. And I've got another 7 full days of, as we're recording this, another 7 full days of Christmas meals to go to.
Oh, wow. Well, I have a full-size scale at my office that we weigh pallets with. So, yeah, I'm at my all-time high as far as weight goes, thanks to Thanksgiving and all the stuff leading up, because we do get cookies in and little sandwich trays. And I was lucky enough actually to get movie passes to Rise of Skywalker out of that. So that was a really fun treat.
Spoiler-free, did you enjoy the movie?
I did enjoy it. There are some things.
Did you enjoy the way it shook out?
Yeah, there's a little. I would say I have mainly nitpicks with it. It wasn't the reviews I've seen are so polarizing in both directions. But I'm somewhere in the camp that I would recommend it. But there's a few little things that I probably would have done differently, and a few questions that I was like, okay. And then there's a few things that just felt really forced, like no pun intended there. Just, you know, fan service that I'm like, oh, that's nice that they did that, but did we need that? I don't know. Yeah. Anyway, it was enjoyable. Really, you know, you go to a Star Wars movie, a lot of people are just so breaking down every little thing about the Star Wars universe, but the Star Wars movies typically have a formula, and you know you're going to get the best special effects there are, and this one kind of was more into that world, say, than The Last Jedi was, you know, the last movie. So you definitely need to see it in theater.
Well, that's not going to happen for me, but I really do look forward to watching it here in about 8, 9, 10 years or so.
Yeah, I've already put a message out. We're going to try to get a group together and do a roundtable review here before the year's out to release here on the podcast channel. But
I should set in on that podcast, having not watched the movie. And everything everybody says, be like, wait. What, really? Really?
That might be more entertaining than listening to us go back and forth. Especially if there's some, you know, polarizing stuff that gets brought up and we start losing, dropping some staffers. Oh, God. I hope it doesn't come to that. But, you know, it's over the last, you know, since this new trilogy started. And I'm in the same part of that as well, of being really staunch on my opinions and views, but we really shouldn't be, you know, traveling down that path. We just enjoy the film for what it is, and yeah, if we want to critique it, sure, but you know, yeah, it's all fun.
It's best left to be critiqued way on down the line, like I don't even know how to solve them. The original trilogy, the new trilogy, the second the Phantom Menace, that trilogy. When that came out, like especially The Phantom Menace, was really polarizing.
Oh, yeah.
But now with 20 years of reflection, you're like, eh. you're not that strong either way, you know, anymore.
I feel the same way, yeah.
You know, it was what it was. In the grand scheme of things, it was one of the weaker entries, but there was nothing overly, you know, bad about it. And
that's true.
Nothing stood out about it either, but.
That's right. Well, give us what you're going to do for Christmas with your family. What kind of plans you've got laid out?
Well, to kind of lift the veil here and break down the fourth wall, we're recording this on Saturday because we know we're going to be so busy leading up to Christmas. But
Right. Tomorrow
I've got a Christmas dinner to go to. Monday, I'm traveling to North Carolina for lunch with some old friends. And Monday night, I'm traveling to have dinner with another set of old friends. Tuesday, Christmas Eve, we've got my wife's family's big Christmas party. Of course, Christmas Day is the kids and Christmas dinner here at home. Much like people have heard me talk about doing Sunday dinners and feeding everybody. Well, Christmas is a bigger version of that, feeding everybody around on Christmas Day. The day after that, we go to my wife's dad's for Christmas dinner. I think Friday we're fending for ourselves, so it may be pizza. But on Saturday, we're going to my mom and dad's, where ever since I was a kid, because my dad always had so many people come over visiting on Christmas Day because he ran, you know, a local business. She always made Christmas breakfast, and so we're going to her house for that on Saturday. Full spread, bacon, sausage, ham, eggs, hash browns, pancakes, biscuits, and gravy. So, yeah, I've got a full week of stuff going on here. But it'll really ramp up Christmas Eve when I have to. When I'll go out and make my last Christmas purchase, and you know, the kids are getting excited, and while we're waiting on the wife to finish stuff up, that's generally when we watch the 2-part Saved by the Bell Christmas episode, and then the Christmas party, and then Christmas Day, of course. Is I like a lazy Christmas Day, and it is a little more low key now that the kids are a little older and want to sleep in. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got kids when they're 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You know, they're beating on your bedroom door at 3:30 a.m. like, you know, Santa came.
Yeah, yeah.
But now they're like, can we wait till like 11 to get up? Yes, yes, we can. It's like, well, you can. I can't. I got to get up and be. I'm cooking for 30 people. I got to get up and get after it. So,
yeah.
It's a shame when you have to take a break from cooking just to open presents and then go back to getting food ready for everybody.
Do you open any on Christmas Eve?
You know, when I was a kid, we did. And then when I got a little older, we switched to Christmas Day. Just, you know, the excitement was gone. And my kids, I have held on to the Christmas morning tradition. Because when we go to the family Christmas party, they've got a couple aunts who bring them a little something. And then Santa Claus actually shows up every year and brings everybody something. So they get 2 or 3 little things to hold them over till the main event on Christmas morning.
Cool. Yeah, I was allowed maybe to open some presents from the distant relatives on Christmas Eve. My parents would relent every once in a while, but we mostly held to the Christmas morning tradition. And yeah, I had to, I think, stay in bed till at least 7 or something, which was hard to do.
I did institute one rule ever since my kids were born. On Christmas morning, nobody opens a present until everybody has had breakfast. And that would kind of kill the excitement just a little bit, and they'd gear down. But I think my old man had it figured out. We had 2 family Christmas parties to go to on Christmas Eve, and we'd come home and we'd open all our presents, because then he knew the next morning I wasn't going to be in there at 4 a.m. wanting him to get up. You know, I would get up and occupy myself with whatever new Nintendo game I got, and he could sleep till 9 or 10 a.m.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I get that. I'm the littlest one, she will probably be up early. My middle son, I take him to school every morning, and we leave here at like about 6:40. So he's up. He doesn't sleep in anymore. So the only thing that I let them do is you can dive right into your stocking. Get everything you want to out of the stocking. You can check that out. Just don't touch any other presents until everybody's up. So once I start hearing some rattling out there, you know, usually then they all head out and they'll dive into their stocking, and then we'll start opening presents from Santa and from the family, you know. Yeah. So
I'm one of those cool dads that are like, leave me alone until I've had coffee and a cigarette, and then we'll open presents.
Yeah, I don't. Usually we go up and we'll be straight for the coffee, but I'll let them dive into that. At least they'll get some enjoyment of seeing something new while we're still trying to get awake and get to our coffee. You know?
Well, we had it worked out perfect. My wife's Christmas morning tradition, along with what I started of not opening a present till breakfast. Her grandfather used to get up, or her grandparents would get up and make so many dozens of those Pillsbury orange sweet rolls.
Right.
And they would take them around to all the grandkids on Christmas morning early. And they'd visit with each one of them for about 15 minutes to see what they got for Christmas and drop off rolls and go on to the next household. And so that's what we actually have for breakfast. So they don't have to wait long on somebody to make breakfast. You're just popping these things in the oven for 10 minutes and you're eating, and then you're opening presents. So we still carry that on. Actually, my wife's uncle now goes around and visits all the grandkids in the family, since Paul's the patriarch of the family is no longer with us. He kind of took over that. He goes around early, like 8 a.m. to visit all the young grandkids and let them show off what they got for Christmas. So
that's cool.
It's a good time. And he also is the one who the Christmas party's at his house on Christmas Eve, and he sneaks downstairs at some point when everybody's distracted, puts on the Santa suit, gets the sack of presents everybody brought for their kids, and here he comes knocking on the front door and comes in and hands out presents, and everybody sits on his lap and takes pictures with him, and he sneaks off. And I always make the joke every year when the kids are all excited playing with their stuff and he's already changed, comes back. I'm like, Sammy, that's like the ninth year in a row you've been in the bathroom when Santa Claus came. And he's like, did you shut up?
Batman and Bruce Wayne. Yep. Yeah. That's cool. That's like you kind of kept that going within the family. And we don't have a lot of huge family gatherings. Usually Thanksgiving is the biggest because we've got in-laws this way and that way and family all over the place that my wife and her two sisters aren't always all together, plus her parents who are in Florida. So we get that mainly in Thanksgiving, and then around Christmas it's usually, well, what are you doing this year? I don't know. I think we're gonna stay home and open our presents here. Okay. And that's kind of how it happened this year with the flu and people being sick. I think we're gonna leave right after we open presents and get our showers for Florida then, and go down and spend the rest of Christmas Day there and have a Christmas dinner with my in-laws.
Well, that'll be nice.
Yeah. And all my family are up north, so it's a little difficult, but we always, you know, pick up the phone and we'll talk for quite a while with my parents and some extended family and friends. So, good stuff. Are you shuffling cards there? What are you doing?
I'm cutting something. Man, I'm telling you, I'm busy leading up to Christmas.
Yeah, speaking of fourth wall.
There we go.
Rapid presents.
Christmas is their biggest family get-together. That or the 4th of July. We here at our place on our property host a big 4th of July shindig with games and music and fireworks and food. And I think we end up having more people here for that than we do there for Christmas. But it's, you know, my kids, I've told them, I'm like, I can't wait till we stop going over there and start doing it here at our house. And it's just like, you know, I just spoke bad about the Pope when I say stuff like that. They're like, no, we're always going to Sherry's for Christmas. I'm like, whatever you want.
Yeah, that's a step, you know, being the host. But it sounds like you people know that they're welcome at, you know, during the holidays. We cooking that much food, gosh. I'd be showing up knocking at your door.
I relish hosting people. You know, I mean, we've had brandied cherries working up since June. We've got anything you would want will be here for Christmas. People stop by and have Christmas dinner or just have a snack. I got a couple friends I go see on Christmas Eve too. Their mother passed away. It's been about 10 years ago now. And she always made this big breakfast. And these two brothers, they live together. And so they keep her memory alive by they get up and fix everything you could imagine for breakfast and tons of it. And it's open invitation. Stop by anytime from 6 to noon. And, you know, different people I know will be there at different times. And they'll have about 30 people come through, their friends and stuff. And I'll stop by there when I go out shopping and have a biscuit and some bacon with them and sit and talk for a half hour, and somebody will roll in and people rolling out. And it's really cool what they do too. So stop by here on Christmas Day.
Well, that's good. You get to visit people, and you know, the age old rule of company coming over was a big deal, and we just don't get that nowadays. At least I don't. Sounds like things are a little more tight knit with your family and friends in that area than they are here. But
it takes a little bit of effort. When I was young, my dad had his business. He knew every other businessman in town. And we would start on the 23rd, and I'd go with him. He would go visit every business in town and just stand and talk for 10, 15 minutes. And we'd go on to the next one, and then we'd continue on into Christmas Eve. And so, you know, going to visit people or having people come over to visit has always been a part of my Christmas, and I couldn't imagine not doing it. Like, that's why I'm going to North Carolina on Monday. I go see these guys that I knew a decade ago. They're all still there in that area. We get together and have lunch before Christmas every year, you know, and it's just something I've always done. It's something I hope I'm always able to do.
That's cool. Yeah, yeah, it's good to.
If you weren't 9 hours away, I would swing by and see you on Christmas Eve.
Yeah, no, I would be happy to host you. I wouldn't guarantee we would have food. I'd be going to the pantry, but I, you know, instead of the oven, but you know, you'd still be welcome. It would be fun. So, yeah, I was just thinking a little bit today about just this year. We're up to our, I think, 7th month now in the Retro Network, and just thinking about all the other, the people that we've kind of met along the way, some that you were connected with, some were, that I were connected with, and we've kind of blended all that together, and it's been a fun ride. It's been fun to get to know some people that I just knew as acquaintances on a deeper level, and then just seeing how people have contributed and, you know, their personalities just through podcasting has been really fun, getting to know them that way. So, yeah, it's, we've been blessed, man. We've been blessed.
We're like a big modern Brady Bunch. You brought your kids. I brought mine.
Oh, gosh. We'll figure out which parent each of us are at a later time.
Yeah, as we found out much later after that show, they both had the same tendencies anyway. So
that's true.
It don't really matter.
I guess so. But yeah, it's been fun, man. I've had a really good time with the podcast and getting to know, like I said, the people over there on Slack that we use to connect with, and just so it's sometimes it's to throw out ideas, and sometimes it's just to BS. Mm-hmm. And it's good to have that. That tight knit kind of group together throughout the year, you can get out your creative content, create and it with other people.
And not just the people who are in the network. I mean, we've met and heard from on a regular basis, a lot of great listeners who comment on stuff on Twitter. We interact with, people I'd never interacted or seen before, I interact with almost on a daily basis with some of them now. Yep. It's been really cool. I really like what we've been able to do at the network in just 7 months in. You and I, we kind of had some thoughts and dreams when we started it. Not that this hasn't traveled down that path, but it's been different and more than I expected in a short time. It's been really good.
Yeah, definitely agree with that.
It really makes it worth, it validates why we done it to begin with. It's been great.
Yeah. A great present on this Christmas, and just a Merry Christmas to you and your family. I have a box under my tree, thanks to you, with some stuff in it that I have not opened yet. I'm going to save it for Christmas.
Did you watch the video of Adam opening what I sent him?
I did. Yes. Yeah. That was great. Unfortunately, I have not gotten, I've accumulated some stuff from thrift stores and everything. I was like, this would be perfect for Mick. Have not gotten in the mail yet. So you'll have a nice present to put under your New Year's tree. How about that? When do you take the tree down? Do you leave it up after 2 years and all that?
I don't know when the wife takes it down. I'm usually not here. I don't think she don't like taking me down till New Year or after.
Yeah, I'm the same way. So you can do your Christmas from me after the New Year when you still have the tree up.
Yeah. Very possible. Very possible. But Merry Christmas to you and your family, too. Hopefully Santa brings a quick recovery from the flu for everybody and a safe trip to Florida.
I appreciate that. And be safe in your travels. And here's a nice segue. As you're traveling and listening to this show over Christmas, on Christmas Eve, hopefully, or even Christmas Day, we have one of our outtake shows to gift to you. We've already released episode 4 just this past week over on Patreon to all of our supporters over there. But as we did with the first episode, we are going to go ahead and release the second one to everybody to enjoy. There's some great little nuggets in there. Of course, all the behind the scenes stuff and mistakes and even some Mickey jokes. In this second episode, you're going to get Mick's recipe for Appalachian cough syrup.
Oh, perfect time of year for that, too.
That's right.
Y'all would already be over the flu if you'd have listened to that and make it.
Yeah, man.
That's what I should have sent you for Christmas.
That's what you, we could have used it, man.
they got these interstate commerce laws and revenue things that you can't really get away with that stuff.
Going across state lines, yeah. Got to be careful. But some great stuff in there. There's also the book reading incident, if you remember that, Mick, when I accused of flipping through the JCPenney catalog during the recurrent events.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was just my notes.
Yeah, and that was later brought up, too, when we were on the phone with Tony. You'll hear harping on me for accusing you of reading the JCPenney catalog. But some great stuff in there.
That's the episode that has the stuff from Tony and I doing the show.
Not you separately. This is the first time when all three of us were together.
Oh.
And you couldn't make your phone stop buzzing. And there's also your honeymoon details in that one, too. I was listening today. going to the
I'm going to have to listen to that again.
Yeah.
It's been a while since I listened to that Outtake show. I'm going to have to, when we get off of here, I'm going to have to pull it up and listen to it myself.
So, yeah, it's a fun show. There are a couple explicit words in there just from back.
No.
Yeah. We're creating a streak here, man, of explicit shows in the channel. But, yeah, I'm going to have to mark that one explicit, too, because I didn't feel like going back and editing it out. Being a behind-the-scenes stuff, you can get to hear all of the fun things we say, but it was a fun show, and I love these outtake shows. You get a little pull back of the curtain, you know.
Uh-huh.
So, well, I think that's going to be it for our little segment here before we get into the outtake. So, again, we appreciate everybody listening and listening to us throughout the year, and please be sure to have a Merry Christmas, be safe in your travels, and we will be back the following week to talk about something retro. Sure, we will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Merry Christmas, everybody.
Hey, Santa Claus. Huh. Hey, Santa Claus. Huh. Hey, Santa Claus. Santa Claus. Santa Claus. Huh. Hey, Santa Claus. Huh. Hey, Santa Claus.
Yes, Jason and Mickey back for another week of the Retro Network podcast. And I just screwed up that network.
Add right, that to the next outtake show.
Bleep, 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 blop, bloop. All right. Try it again. As I sip my peach mellow yellow.
I had an idea for a Patreon exclusive show. We just have like a round table talk. We get four or five people on from the network, but we state this rule, like you have to have three adult beverages before the podcast.
Okay.
And that
the drunk episode.
Well, not drunk. Come on. Three drinks, really? Lightweight.
Depends on what you're drinking.
Yeah, well, that's true.
My wife can get drunk on half a bottle of wine cooler, so.
Oh, wine coolers.
Every time she, like, gets the courage up to have a drink, I'm like finishing half of it for her. Just cannot hold her liquor.
Well, coming from the Appalachian Mountains, you learn at an early age to tolerate moonshine and
strong drink. Yep.
Jack Daniels. And yeah, of course, I mean, hell, even my kids have a higher tolerance than most people just because I still make old fashioned Appalachian cough syrup every fall and winter and they get sick. It's like, here, take a swig of this. And it works better than anything you'll buy at the grocery store or Walgreens.
I'm curious now, what's the ingredients in Appalachian cough syrup?
Well, you can put this on an outtake episode. You start with, you've been to Cracker Barrel, you've seen those boxes of rock candy.
Yes. Oh, yes. I love rock candy.
You start with a box of rock candy. You put it in a quart jar. You pour enough whiskey over it, just enough to cover it. You let it dissolve. It takes about 2 days. That's going to make it palatable. Then, also, at Cracker Barrel, you buy a bag of whorehound candy. You crush the whorehound candy up. You dissolve it down with a little bit of whiskey in a saucepan till it all dissolves. You add it to the jar. Then you add in half a cup of honey, half a cup of lemon juice, and then you fill the jar the rest of the way with whiskey, and it keeps all year. And if you get into the deep dive on the ingredients, most of your NyQuils and stuff have alcohol in them. This is just a better version of it. But no, seriously, if you have a fever or something, a big swig of that, go to bed. You have a head cold, a cough, take a big swig before bed. You do feel much, much better the next morning when you get up. And it's been used in these parts for, I guess, since whiskey was invented.
Interesting. Okay. My wife makes her own, like, vanilla with vodka. And I don't know what else all goes in there, but
That's a good start just with that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, vanilla vodka. There you go. Interesting. Okay. All right. Well, let's get going here on the recurrent events. This coming, according to Deadline, the updated series will showcase a group of friends struggling with career and commitment. Are you reading a book? And
who, me?
Yes, you. I just hear these pages turning or something.
Sorry, I'm making notes. Stuff I don't want to miss later this fall.
He's like, all right, that was enough for that topic. I'm going to keep rolling on this book. all right. August. I don't think that's right. I don't think it was August 6th.
I think August 6th was a Wednesday that year. That's not right. That show was on Tuesday.
Because 6th was last week when we recorded. Let me go over to my topics real quick on my phone.
Well, just add 7 days to it. Call it the 13th. This week, 20 years ago.
Yeah. Shoot. It was the 16th, not the 6th. Okay. I'm missing numbers in the notes here. What's going on? Okay. Okay. I started recording. I'm just going to start recording as soon as we get on the phone from now on.
Oh, yeah, because you never know when you're going to catch something good.
Right.
Hey, I listened to that whole outtakes thing. That was masterfully put together, for one. And two, it was weirdly interesting.
I was thinking maybe I need like a little transition effect in between each, because you kind of group it together, then it, I don't know. It does make it sound more like strung together without an effect and would be like one consistent thought. But just for separation of going from, you know, episode to episode and just plugging in little clips, I don't know. I don't know if we need something in between or not.
Well, if you ever decide to, just some kind of static sound, you know, like switching dials on a radio. Mm-hmm. There. Yep, and then, you know, there it is.
Yeah. Or maybe the farting on a snare drum sound that we've been in between each one. Yeah. I still have yet to find a good sound effect for that.
Well, you brought something up. It's been over a week ago now that Adam and Chad were doing a TRN talk thing. When is that? Coming.
It's in the bank. Yeah, we recorded that. I actually left work early Wednesday to pull that one off. So I just got to finish up. I'm going to do a little intro, outro music and just something quick.
You know, I was thinking those TRN talks may be good, some of them, for Patreon exclusives.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't know. Just kind of like you used to do the rank 'em episodes, just extended versions of our general discussions on some topic, maybe once a month or something, put on Patreon as a standalone TRN talk on dining experiences we miss, you know, where we go in depth on Pizza Hut and you can tell your dad's buffet stories and Showbiz Pizza and just go on and on and on with that stuff.
You said the S word, Showbiz Pizza. Love Showbiz.
You know, I never got to eat there.
Oh, man. Your childhood was ruined.
Well, there was one over an hour away, and we just never went to it.
Yeah. Ours was, 45 minutes away. I remember having at least one birthday there, or maybe going to somebody's birthday that was there, but... The best thing about it, man, when we walked in the door, they had this huge, like a barrel And at the top, it was just loaded with tokens. And everybody in the party, like the birthday party, could reach a get a fistful of tokens and just
whatever
shove them
pulled out.
Yeah, just shove in your pockets. They do that somewhat now with Chuck E. Cheese. They give you like a little cup and then you'll fill it up with however many tokens or something. But I just remember reaching my hand in there and be like, oh, and I went right for Super Contra.
My dad used to do that with change. He'd put all this loose change in a coffee can.
Uh-huh.
And when my kids were a lot smaller and we'd go visit, he'd let them each reach a hand in, and whatever they could hold on to as they pulled their hand out, they could take home. And it was full of quarters and dimes, nickels and pennies. And, you know, my oldest was the first one to get smart. She'd kind of wedge her hand down in the side and kind of try to lift up like a forklift.
Nice.
Bring up a whole pile. Another thought. Well, shit, it just left me. What was I going to say? Oh, as we're doing these flick chart top tens, I thought that may be a good Patreon exclusive, is after we do like the 80s and 90s or 70s or whatever, we do our overall top 10 as just a standalone Patreon show, maybe.
Okay. Yeah. Or we could go into 11 through 20 or something.
Yeah. Something that like flick chart, I think, will generate some more stuff for us to talk about.
Yeah. Once I figured out you could filter by the decade and only those movies would show up, I went through a ton last night. And so I'm very good to go. I've got like 5 pages worth of a list just for the 80s. So that's over 100. That's probably close to 100 movies I've ranked on mine just for the 80s. I'm up to 746 rankings, 450 total movies.
It gets to be a little addictive, doesn't it?
It does. Well, and as soon as I'm like, okay, I think I got enough for the 80s, I jumped over the 90s. I'm like, well, depending on what we're going to do today.
Yeah.
So I just kept going and going and going.
And it'd
be fun to go backwards too, like 70s and 60s, to see what we've actually watched or still would watch, you know.
And I love all the different posters. It's not like every time the Goonies comes up, you're getting the same poster every time.
Yeah.
It's always something different, which is great. And I'll sit there and stare at and study the pictures. Oh, but we'll talk more about it.
Yeah, I was going to say, let's
we'll give them some free advertising because it's such a fun site.
All right. Well, let's get going on this.
Ice cream sandwiches. I'm not going to read any farther because I want to
wait
and let you surprise me with that horrible news.
Let's see. Pizza Hut. Oh, this is out for a little bit here.
Well, it may be the old story from like a month ago.
It says August 7th.
Oh, okay. Well, that's still new enough.
Yeah, 2 weeks.
But I've had several people text and email me about it. And I'm like, yeah, I seen it. I tried to tell them. Don't blame me. The Fox Business headline is Pizza Hut closing hundreds of restaurants as it pushes delivery. I think all 500 of these that are closing are all dine-in locations.
Mm-hmm.
Which,
good job.
Plan to lean in to accelerate the transition of our Pizza Hut U.S. estate to a more modern delivery and carry-out focused base. Ultimately positioned Pizza Hut brand for many years of faster growth in the U.S. Nobody wants to.
I've got this one from People has the total number of like dine-in versus express locations. So I'll throw those numbers in there.
That's just sad. To know what it used to be, it's just sad.
My dad will not eat at hardly any place that doesn't have a buffet. And he like pushed. Don't ask me why. I have no idea why. But that was one of the things they loved about Pizza Hut, because they brought the buffet there for like lunch and dinner. And then I think they just do lunch now at the new location. But he's big in like Kentucky Fried Chicken, man. He wouldn't eat a Kentucky Fried. Where's the buffet? What happened to the buffet? Who cares?
Well,
it's chicken.
Bang for your buck.
I guess so, but I don't know. Anyway. No, I don't want a free tote. Take me back to the article. I'm down. Got my Trapper Keeper. That was a good idea. I like that. It's going to be fun. Coming up, we've got our topic. Wow.
Cut. That's for a Russian edition of the show.
Yeah. Yikes. All right. Yeah.
Reminds me of a joke. A woman got arrested for shoplifting, and the judge asked the guy at the grocery store, what'd she steal? And he said, she stole a can of pear halves. And the judge said, okay, how many was in there? He's like, well, there's four halves in a can. Well, I'm giving her one day in jail forever. Half in there, and her husband spoke up and said, Your Honor, she also stole a can of corn.
Nice.
Yeah, I'm in a room separate from where my kids are in the TV room there, so hopefully it's quiet in here for the most part.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
And my wife, she's going to be leaving here shortly with my daughter, and she'll probably burst in and let me know that she's leaving at whatever point that will be. I may have to like run throughout the house, hiding in different places from from the boys so they don't find me. Maybe run out to the truck and hide in there.
Whatever you got to do.
I told my oldest what I'd be doing. So if he needed anything, if there was blood involved.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Just do what I do with my kids. Just set up some lawn darts outside and tell them to have at it, and they'll stay out there for hours.
Yeah. Right.
You might see some blood then.
See a little bit of blood, probably. The mind wouldn't know how to handle them. Wouldn't even know what they were. So.
This is true.
I think some of the toys they have now are about as dangerous. Some of these drones and things that can fly.
Yeah.
Whip right into your face.
What was that noise? Sounded like a phone vibrating or something?
I don't know what that was.
Yeah, sorry. That was me.
It almost sounded like a big rig. I mean, yeah. Are you on a different headset today?
No, it was just a stinking text message coming through.
You sound a little more, I don't know, you sound different today.
Well, I had a full night's sleep, maybe that's it.
Okay, whatever.
I don't know, maybe the kids have had these headphones or something that I'm using, I don't know.
What is your schedule, Mickey?
Oh my goodness. What, work or?
Because all I ever hear about is how busy you are. So I'm like, does he ever get time to relax?
Well, let's see here. I sleep from 4:30 to 8:30 in the morning. And then I'm up piddling with the retro network for a little bit, working with my online store. I'm also a consultant for small businesses here in town. So I'm running out, and then it's back home, eat lunch, take a shower, head to work, leave about 2:30-ish, and then I get home about 4 a.m. So that's my schedule these days.
But you get Saturday off, right?
No, not usually. I worked in yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Saturdays are short, so we only work 8 hours on Saturdays.
That would be, I don't know that I can handle that.
And that's not counting trying to find a few minutes here and there to work around the property, and it's a lot.
Well, you balance it pretty well, I think. Well, you always sound refreshed.
Man, you're to hear me when I actually am refreshed. My old man always said that a man will rust out before he'll wear out. So I kind of take that to heart.
Yeah, right.
This is true.
Or he'll rust out before he'll wear out. Something like one of those two. Point is, don't sit around.
No. Every person that I've known that, well, that has retired and not necessarily wanted to, they always end up dying early.
Yeah, so. I see it too, man. My goal with retirement is to be able to do what I want to do, not what I have to do.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't plan on ever stopping doing anything, you know. I just want to get to the point where, I just want to bag groceries like 30 hours a week.
Right. There's a fellow that I work with. He's 81 or 82 maybe. And man, I hope I'm still doing what he's doing when I'm that age.
I hope I'm not working when I'm 81 or 82. Well,
yeah, right.
Some people can't get away from it, though. I understand that.
Yeah, he's just one of those people that can't stop.
I swear, it sounds like a foghorn.
That's what I was thinking. It sounds like a foghorn.
It's just my text notification. I'm trying to figure out how to turn it off. Don't judge me, all right?
Yeah, he's next to a body of water somewhere, and must be boats going by.
Wah, wah. I turn on this do not disturb thing. That would probably work, won't it? Yeah. The fantasy football draft is here in a few hours, and everybody's trying to get in touch with me. I bet.
Don't draft Andrew Luck. That's my tip of the day.
Well, you know, we're a dynasty keeper league, and my cousin was really looking forward to this season, but he kept Andrew Luck, so I got bad news for him.
Yeah.
Is there a way to mute myself, like if somebody comes in here?
Yeah. It should be the little microphone circular icon there.
Oh, okay. Wait a minute. Let me try this. Okay, you didn't hear me there. Okay.
Yep.
That works. That way, if all of a sudden there's a brawl that I need to go, work out the issues of, then I can turn that microphone off.
Basically, you want me to hit mute? Do you want me to hit mute when I turn the pages in my book so you don't think I'm bored or reading something over here?
I swear, it just sounded like you were like thumbing through a JCPenney catalog or something.
I've got my notebook here. I take notes, and I've got notes, and I turn the page, and he gets all over me last week. What are you doing, reading a book?
Well, I didn't know you were that old school and actually using a pencil and paper.
Hey, as busy as I am, man, these Moleskine books are my life. I fill one of these suckers up about every 6 months. And there for a while,
forget
I found
using
a cheap,
iPads.
Yeah,
forget that. That's too complicated. I found a cheap source for these books for a while when Tony had them in the Retro Days Point store. I think I ordered several of them from
I guess I need to, may have to send you more if you're flipping through that many pages.
Gosh. Well, so the do not disturb didn't work.
You got it like sitting on a table or something, or
yeah.
It sounds like you got it like sitting. It sounds like you got it sitting on the microphone.
Well, no. See, I've got the microphone plugged into the phone, and I guess that. Let me see if I can turn that. This was a freaking notification. It's not usually this bad.
Got to keep those hands free, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, because, you know, I need to flip through my JCPenney catalog when Jason talks about something I'm not interested in.
Yeah, right.
Well, I've turned off all the notifications I know how to turn off. If anything else happens, we'll just have to edit it out or something. I don't know what to tell you.
Okay.
Or just say that beware of foghorns, chips loading.
Yeah. I'm filming live from the Bermuda Triangle this week. Gilligan's Island here.
So I will do I kind of keep, I'll keep quiet, and then whenever I'll interject when you say, whenever you mention me.
Yeah, or... yeah, I'll give you a cue. It won't be that long once we get rolling. We'll let everybody know you're on the line, and then I just kind of, I'm the one that mainly kind of runs through the outline. Mickey, did you have anything to add to any of it?
Did we have an outline this week?
We did.
Yeah,
I said it to you.
No.
Are you fooling with me? Or
I am, but I told you, I usually wing it anyway. I just glance at it. I never actually read it.
He didn't have time to write it all down in his notebook.
You're right.
I got a lot of it wrote down. Actually, not this week, I don't. But I got some stuff wrote down, though. But no, I don't have anything really to add to it.
Okay.
It'll just pop off the top of my head at the most inconvenient time, like usual.
Well, feel free to interject.
Before we get started.
Yeah, before we get started. All right. Let's, I'll come in, greet Mickey, and then we'll bring in Tony soon after that. And then I just basically go right down through the list. So, and we take a little pause to get a drink, whatever, in between segments,
okay,
as you've heard.
yeah.
So
those are some of the best, things to listen to.
All right.
Well, cracking open the pop can.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, maybe I'll wait for that. When we're on the air, so I got something I can crack open here. all right, here we go. All right, we're going to take a little break here. Oh, did you hear that?
Oh, I did.
That was an ice cold bottle of cheer wine.
Oh, ooh. No way.
I went to World Market yesterday. Yep. I was like, I had cheer wine on the brain.
Well, I have a half watered down cup of Meliella from Wednesday, so I just went up to you.
Well, speaking of cheer wine, you know, I do a lot of cooking around here. I pride myself on creating things, and I've been working out a recipe for this Halloween season for the kids' Halloween blood punch, and I'm going to be able to use cheer wine as a base for it. So it's got the right color, and you know it's got the right flavor. So
blood punch. Nice. Yes.
Can that be bottled and shipped?
Possibly. Possibly. But if not, I'll be putting at least on Retro Ramblings anyway, the recipe for that this
October.
So you'll be able to copy it. Well, I don't know. Can you get cheer wine where you're at?
I cannot.
Oh, okay.
I'm gonna have to figure out
a way to get you some in your hands then. Yeah.
Did you say you could order it though, correct?
Yeah, you can from Cheerwine's website.
Well, you're gonna have to do a condensed recipe because I can only get these little 12-ounce bottles. I can't get 2 liters.
No 2 liters.
All right. Well, let's get into this. We'll keep on rolling. Keeping going, there's an outtake for you.
Right.
And they've got some big names coming there. You got Cary Elwes, who is, I hear some kids.
They found you.
They did.
Oh, whoops. I forgot to mute my mic.
All right, get your drink.
What was it? What did you say? Moof? What?
The Moops.
The Moops?
From Seinfeld? You remember that episode?
Oh, well, see, I didn't watch a lot of Seinfeld, so I'm out of the loop on that.
It's just this funny episode. George goes off to... He ends up visiting this dude's house where they've got a bubble boy. He's like the boy in the plastic bubble.
Yeah.
He's playing Trivial Pursuit with him, and the dude is kicking George's rear end, and and there's a misprint on the card, and George asks him the question. He goes, "It's easy, it's the Moors." Somebody about invading England. He goes, "I'm sorry, it's the Moops." That's a misprint, you idiot. I'm sorry, it says Moops. It's kind of an iconic moment in the series. I'd say most people would put that, what did you say, your top 10 moments, Jason?
Of yeah, the Bubble Boy episode. Yeah, it's up there.
So people listening will probably get it anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm one of those few. I don't think there's a lot of people out there that didn't get into Seinfeld, so say you're pretty safe.
Okay. All right. Well, you ready with your...
Use the restroom.
Okay.
Take a restroom break here.
Go be for right it. Back.
Leave your headset on. It'll make for a good outtake.
The Naked Gun, remember?
Yeah.
La 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 la. That's like my favorite scene. Oh my gosh. Now I want to watch that movie. Frank Drebin. Police Squad. All right, so you want to do the little promotion thing when we sign off? Or before we sign off, actually. After we're done with Tony?
Yeah, before you and I get off the phone, we can record that. I think we should tack it on at the very beginning before the intro of our show.
Yeah, so that way if they say, sorry, we didn't like it, we can take it out easily.
Yeah.
Hey, the under the curated content, the Halloween pranks of an 80s teenager that I did, that link goes to the... sprinkle the Demogorgon sprinkler on Amazon.
Ah, well, I see that. Well, I can fix it, or we can get some free Amazon cookies.
Hey, what way in the world?
I'll fix that.
Bastards. Yeah.
Switch advertising there.
Yeah.
What was the tribute for the first episode they were doing this year with the Goldbergs?
The National Lampoon's Vacation.
That's right. I couldn't remember. I'd heard that, and I couldn't remember what it was. That'll be fun.
Yeah, it's going to be fun.
Somebody, it seems like I had heard that Christy Brinkley.
Mm-hmm. You heard it from us.
Okay, yeah. Correct. From you.
Yeah, Christy Brinkley and Anthony Michael Hall, yep.
Yeah, that's it.
They're going to be in there.
Oh, hell, look, you sent notes for today, didn't you?
I did.
I glanced at him. I did my homework too.
Okay, good. That's all I ask. Just do the homework. Everything else you can just kind of meh. Okay. Well, everybody ready?
Yes.
Let's go ahead and get into this. And I'm just kind of winging it, as Mick is probably as well. So I didn't take down any notes other than what's on the outline there. So
I've been making free to notes. I've been making notes on He-Man for 40 years, man.
Well, there you go, man.
That's right.
Just pull a journal off the shelf, and you're ready to go.
I got it all saved in the hard drive up here in my head right now.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, likewise.
Okay. Well, that'll be fun, more spontaneous then than we're just reading history notes. So, okay, here we go.
You know, they should have released a Mertman and Teela 2-pack.
Yes.
Don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
We need a green Teela figure. with Merman's, like, armor.
Yeah, right.
You know, it wasn't until, like, last year that I realized, like, when I'm watching that documentary, that they just made Stinkor out of Merman. That never connected with me as like a kid or anything.
Really? Yeah.
Never. I swear to God. I was like,
yeah.
Oh, that makes sense. And then Moss Man was Beast Man. Oh my God. And it was like this huge revelation that I could never reveal online, you know, losing my retro credit or something. But
and made Prince Adam and Faker out of He-Man too.
Now that was a little bit more obvious. Okay.
Yeah, slightly.
But the merman, I never made the Merman and Stinkor connection.
Must have been the Mechaneck armor was just it threw you off.
Yeah, hiding his face. Yeah.
He probably didn't realize that either until you just mentioned it.
Nope.
I just mentioned it now. He just realized that was Mechaneck's armor.
Oh, gosh.
All kind of revelations coming.
Yeah. Yeah, as much as Filmation recycled the scenes, you know, they recycled the parts
exactly
to make the toys. Gosh. All right.
So it sounds better this week. I have the same setup this week as I did last week with Tony on the call that it sounded like crap.
Yeah. So it must be like when you get multiple people on the line, it's messing with whatever.
It may be because I think these, as far as headphones go, I think these sound good for recording. And they should. They were $190.
Holy schmoles.
Which I bought for some other stuff at my old job. Hell, I've had them for 5 years and they still work great.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, it sounds a lot better than what it did last week. So it just must be that extra person that like deafens everything.
Yeah. Which I've been looking, there's a few sets at where I work now that are currently not used. That it's the one-sided headphones with the mic.
Mm-hmm.
And those things are expensive. I think I'm going to try to bring a set of those home and try them because I have to cock these headphones sideways as it is because I can't hear myself talk. If they have noise-canceling headphones that work exceedingly well. I can't hear myself speaking. And I'm like, did I actually say that or was that just in my head? Because I can't tell.
Your voice is in your head talking to you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Tubi is by far and away, I think, the leader in the freebies. Of course, the Roku channel is pretty good, too, though.
Yeah, I'm hooked on Tubi. We've been watching old episodes of Transformers. This last week, I got a little girl hooked on.
What do you use for streaming? Do you have a Roku device?
Roku, yeah.
Okay, do you ever look at their actual Roku channel?
Every once in a while, I've actually watched some episodes of ALF, and I'm trying to think what else.
Well, I come across some weird shit yesterday. Well, not weird. It's just stuff that surprised me. They have the old Joan Rivers talk show on there now.
Really?
Yeah. So they're getting some...
Interesting.
You know, like we're talking about how old content's becoming valuable. I guess that proves it right there.
Yeah, no kidding.
And one of them I found had episodes of Geraldo Rivera's old talk show.
That was Tubi. I saw that last night. And let's save it for the show, man, because I was going to.
Oh, okay. I need to find that episode. Well, it's probably not included because it was a special where they opened Al Capone's vault and there was nothing but a pile of trash in there.
That was what interested me to try to find, but I didn't even look last night. We were in the Transformers. So
well, an actual episode of his show, so it's probably not on there. It was a one-time special thing on Primetime. Probably on YouTube, though.
And I'm going to go get a drink.
All right.
And I'll fold some laundry, too, while I'm at it.
when I got on the Patreon page earlier, I seen Tony's comment about that when you showed off your workspace there.
Yes. That's good. No tier one this week, just apple peach hard cider.
Oh, apple peach hard cider.
I got that at World Market. Good stuff.
We make our own hard cider this time of year. Well, here towards the end of the month when the apples. We got a lot of apple orchards around here, and you can go there and get the fresh pressed apple cider with no preservatives and stuff in it that you really need to make the hard cider with. And you can get it dirt cheap. So we turn it into homemade hard apple cider and always take a half a gallon of that, put it in a Tupperware dish and put it in the freezer and every day scrape the ice off. And after about 3 weeks, what you're left with is about a quart of some very fine sipping applejack, which is good for the winter time. It usually that quart will last all winter, goes along with the Appalachian cough syrup. Maybe you just come in from work and you're really cold and just take a little hit off the applejack and warm up and go on about your evening.
That sounds good.
We found something today, yesterday at the grocery store. I overslept, so I didn't get to try them this morning. We found Entenmann's apple cider donuts.
Okay.
So I'm going to have to try those when we get off of here.
That sounds good to me. I'm all about the donuts. Yeah, so we beat you by, what, 6 months?
Yeah, something like that. We got married. She wanted a big wedding. You know, I told you I proposed on the 4th of July. I did not want, I would have been fine just going to the magistrate's office and getting a document says we were married. But
right.
So I compromised and I gave her 2 months. And I said, whatever you can make happen in 2 months' time, I'll agree to go with. I want you to know that woman can work miracles in 2 damn months. God almighty.
So you had a big, big ordeal?
Bigger than I wanted. We didn't have a lot. We didn't get big enough that we had a live band or anything, but we actually had a wedding planner and this, that, and the other thing. But you know what we done for our honeymoon? We went.
You don't want me to guess. Not after the fireworks story.
Oh, well, we went. Well, this is probably just as good. We went to Charlotte, North Carolina to watch WCW Monday Nitro.
On your honeymoon.
Yeah, well, it was one of the things we'd done on our honeymoon. But it was the night that Ric Flair
was that a little inspiration or something?
Maybe. It was the night, the episode that Ric Flair's son, David Flair, was getting married to Stacy Keibler.
Oh, you're kidding me.
So the theme fit, right?
Yeah.
And being big into wrestling news at the time, and it being Charlotte, North Carolina, Ric had been off TV forever. So... I knew that there's no way they're not bringing him back on TV. He's been gone forever. It's in his hometown. It's the angle where his son's getting married. He's going to be there. So I made a sign that said, "Welcome home, Nature Boy." And so when the surprise came and he came out, the cameraman, I was noticing, we were sitting ringside next to the announcers, and the cameraman up on the apron, I seen his red light go on and he's staring right at me and I'm holding up the "Welcome home, Nature Boy" sign. So I got on television. And the other side of the sign, they
showed. I'm going to go out to YouTube as soon as we're off and try to find that, man.
I will send you the clip. I've had it for a while.
Nice.
We were on camera at the beginning of the episode, too, when they're scanning the crowd, because you can see our sign that says we're on our honeymoon that they got on camera. And I had some wrestling T-shirts made up just before that. And I made her wear one that night. I was wearing one that had this old black and white picture of Ric Flair on it. And on the back of the T-shirt, it said, "If God was a wrestler, his name would be Ric Flair." And everybody was asking me, Where'd you get that?
Yeah.
I'm like, I designed it and made it. And her, she was wearing a Dusty Rhodes T-shirt that said, "The son of a plumber who lived the American dream." And so... later on in her honeymoon, she's wearing that shirt again. We're out shopping or something, and somebody sees it and is, "What does that shirt even mean?" And I'm like, "Dude, you ain't even got the time for me to stand here and explain to you what that shirt means." So, we spent our honeymoon watching wrestling.
So was she into wrestling, or was this just all...
No, she wasn't into wrestling.
Since you agreed to the wedding, she had to agree to the honeymoon, right?
She was not opposed to it, but she wasn't for it. And that goes back to what I was saying during the show there about going to retro days. I've been through that situation where I drag her to something she's not overly into and try to have a good time. It's not as good of a time as it could be.
Right. I understand. Well, that was great. Thanks for sharing.
Yeah, that'll make a good addition to a future Patreon exclusive show.
There you go.
at some point in the future,
a wrestling match on the honeymoon. Wow.
Well, at some point in the future, I'll tell you about our first anniversary when 9/11 happened.
Oof. Oh man.
So yeah, we'll go over that we'll save that for another Outtakes episode.
Okay.
It involves 9/11. It involves the Charlie Daniels Band and some other stuff. So.
Interesting. My 9/11 story is definitely not that interesting. So, wow. Okay. All right. Well, you ready to move on here?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
No problem, man. I like these little in-between little stories and stuff. Because, you know, I don't... How long have we been talking to each other? Maybe a year or two? So, it's fun to hear. Testing, hello? Testing, testing. What the? I hate when I drop off like that.
Yeah, I don't know what that was.
All right, what was I in the middle of?
He's talking about G.I. Joe.
Shut up.
The voice actors and the parachute machines and the vehicle.
You heard that. Yeah.
Oh, you were talking about Duke getting killed off is where we were.
Okay. Actually. Okay.
All right. I've been up for, I don't know, 10 hours or so now. You catch me at a bad time.
What's a better time for you then?
There's not. That's the problem.
See? I can't believe I never sent you the notes. I thought I sent you the notes on this.
No, it's okay. But ever since we took that break, I went outside and I've been laughing myself silly thinking about the urine in the heater thing. So how does he know somebody poured it in there? It's possible they did not use a transfer system.
That's what I was thinking too. I mean, it was okay. Probably him, and he's just standing there taking a piss into the thing. And
well, how old was he? What grade is it? Because that's important too. Because you got to be tall enough to do it. We had a at our high school. We had an outdoor building that just had two classrooms, kind of in the front, with a hallway between them, and then you had an individual men's room and women's room, and then the whole building behind that was the shop. And one day, I was talking last week about the school stories torturing that poor shop teacher. Mm-hmm. He come into our marketing class one day. Told Miss Hill, said someone has defecated in the sink in the men's room.
How would she know?
Well, not that she would. He was just mad. He just came in there to tell her about it because apparently he'd went to wash his hands and the sink was full.
Shit. Sink. My God.
Well, again, you have to kind of look at who's tall enough. So I started this conspiracy theory. Our friend Tiny, he's called Tiny because he is a very tall man. Mm-hmm. But his little brother is even taller than he is. And his little brother had that class with me, and I started telling people, like, well, you know, Bill's the only one tall enough to back up and do that, right?
No. He was on you about that.
Yeah. I still, to this day, bring that up. I'm like, you know, you was the only one ever tall enough to have done that. And he'll just turn around and start whistling and walk on. He's never come right out and admitted it, but we all know. We know what the deal is.
What would cause you to do that? Wow.
Well, you know.
We had, I knew some people in our dorm in college just because we had a hall where there was there two bathrooms? There might have been one on each end. It might have been just the one that was on our end, but we lived like, our room was like right across the hallway from it. But I know people who would piss in their sink at night when they just didn't want to walk the whole way down the end of the hall. I was like, oh, my God.
Can you blame them, really?
Yeah. I brushed my teeth in there, man. I don't want you pissing in the sink. Holy shit.
Well, if you have good aim and it gets straight into the drain, it ain't a big deal.
Oh, God. Welcome, everybody, to another episode of TRN Talk. And I'm...
I'll just leave it in there.
Yeah, just leave it in there. Welcome, everybody, to another episode. Why? It's not another episode. This is just like the second episode.
Still, that makes it another episode.
Yeah. And I'm going to add in a little note here before we get started, just to segue all that together, if I'm going to cut out a break or not. I don't know. We'll see.
Hey, if you don't and you need something to put in there, film just a little or record a 15-second commercial from you about, hey, you know, we got go over to I can put the Roku in our products section.
Maybe that's what we should do. Yeah. We're not officially endorsing anything, but we are.
Oh.
Yeah, maybe we should. I don't know. Whatever. It's our show. It's our opinions.
Yeah, by God. If we want to pee in the heater, we'll pee in the heater.
Pee in the heater. I'm going to use that from now on, man.
You pee in the heater, somebody... I'll go over here and fart on this snare drum. We'll make beautiful music together.
All right. Okay. All right, you ready?
Here we go. I've got to get some asparagus this week at the store.
Okay, yeah. I think we're running kind of long today.
You think?
Yes. Damn, it's 3:20. All right.
Hey, it's 4:20 here.
Yeah. I'm going to have to, I don't know, see if I can cut some stuff out, maybe. All right. I'll let you go, man. I don't know. 2.5 hours. Well, we did have a break in between there when you talked to your mom. I don't know how long that was, but.
It was 8 minutes.
Wow. We are
long. I looked to see how long I'd been gone. It was 8 minutes from the time we hung up till I told you I was ready again.
Shoot.
So.
Okay. Well, there went that theory.
Well, have a good one, man.
All right. You too. See ya.
Bye.